Thank you, Link. Oh, should I say good afternoon? It's a little late. Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I want to thank you, all of you, and Schiller Institute's efforts making the world a better place. And I want to thank the panel for your wonderful speech. I've learned a lot. And thank you for having me here, not to sing, but to speak. When I first got the invitation to speak at this conference, I thought that I could talk about the love relationship between Einstein and his violin, or the Mozart effect on children's developing brain, or how Bach's music would be considered the most valuable advanced creation and cultural heritage in the universe a billion years later. I could have talked about how deep breathing and singing have helped my colleagues, my friends, young children to cure ADDs and anxiety attack or asthmas. But today, I've chosen to just come here to share with you a few true stories from my own experience, my stories. I was born in a city on the Yangtze River in China. The Cultural Revolution was long over then, and we were embracing all the new ideas, cultures. We were having a mini renaissance. My parents encouraged me to embrace, enjoy all the creative, artistic activities, which they were forbidden in the Cultural Revolution to enhance. I enjoyed reciting ancient Chinese poems while studying calligraphy with a master tutor. I liked my dance and music classes and dreamed about becoming either a hurdle runner or gymnast for the Olympics. And my mom, even at my kindergarten age, encouraged me to study English. I hope that helped me today. Life was beautiful, but on a very hot, sunny summer day, my world turned very dark. My mother had an accident and passed away. I was 9 years old. For a long time, I had kept a painful secret to myself. I thought that I was the cause of my mother's death. I thought if I hadn't asked her to take me to the zoo that day, nothing would have happened. I felt that I had no way to redeem my fault, and I was very sad and depressed as a 9-year-old. My sister and my school teachers tried very hard to keep me busy with the school programs. Sister loves music. She often plays LP, turntable, some cassettes, with mostly classical music. One day, there was a singer's album, and one song got my attention. It was Brahms' Lullaby. It was sung in Chinese, so I understood. I loved it so much, as if I was listening to my mother singing. Later, my sister took me to a live concert, and amazingly, a soprano sang the exactly same lullaby. Her voice was otherworldly sounding, without a microphone. I went home and cried my heart out, and soon I learned all the songs I could find that were related to mother's love and childhood. I would sing them whole day long as if I was singing to my mother. At age 13, I joined a youth singing competition in the city, and I won. And two of my competing numbers, songs, were one is the Dvorak, it's called The Song My Mother Taught Me. Another one is a Chinese song, it's called My Mother's Kiss. After the competition, singing has become an important part of my life. Classic music, singing, is like a ray of sunlight lightened up my dark world. At age 15, I had my first official Italian old school voice lesson. And I have to say, I didn't enjoy that much because I had to sing in Italian, which I didn't understand. By the time I went to Shanghai Conservatory of Music, I had gotten out of my depression, and I managed to have my Carnegie debut before my graduation. When I traveled around the world, audiences often ask me, Why do you choose to become a classical singer? And actually, my father used to ask me too, why do you choose seemingly the most difficult profession in the world? You're Chinese, you want to sing opera, and in 8 languages that you don't understand. But I say, I will understand with time. I have to confess, it was not a love for the first sight. Remember my dream of a gymnast, Olympics, and also I didn't like my first lesson because I didn't understand the Italian. But over the years, I had learned to sing in eight languages and managed to speak some of them. And through the language studies, I see the world. I see the world of people. Different languages carry different temperament from different cultural background. But in music, we're all good citizens. Music united us. As I got more access to it, I fell in love with the truthful nature of the art form and the beauty of all the master music works. Think about singing. It's your instrument, like each of you has that instrument. And it's your voice, and with natural acoustics. It's one of the most honest art form. And it doesn't matter who your dad is. You get up, you have to sing. And people judge by your art, not other elements. I also had to learn to love my body and my instrument, embrace and also manage my own emotions and overcome my fear of judgment and imperfection. Over the years, classical singing had made me physically healthier, mentally stronger, emotionally more balanced, and a true, happy, better person in life. One day after my concert, a production, Romeo and Juliet in France, a young teenager came up to me, said, beautiful, beautiful, but why Romeo and Juliet would take 10 minutes to say, I love you? Like, why the duet is so long? I had the same question Years ago, in opera, we always take a long time to say a simple emotion to describe. Like, I would sing whole aria, like half aria, just three words, I love you. But then, by then, I was so proudly to answer her. I said, why not? Isn't that wonderful to celebrate our emotion? Take it, expand it, and celebrate it. And how would you like to change it? Would you like to have Romeo say to Juliet, hey, do you want to hang out? So I think it's, can you tell it's evident I am a more mature person that to answer that question. I felt the connection and conviction, I was very convincing. When I sing well and get into that very, you call it soulful zone of words, poetry, and music, I felt that I am in tune with the world and have lots of warmth and love in my heart. And I feel so free of expression. And this is the intangible magic of music making. When audiences come to me and thanked me in tears, say how much my voices has inspired them and made goosebumps with them to have goosebumps, I think that's a good thing. I said to them, like, I am very thankful that you are here and to share all the masterpieces with me to make me feel what I do has meaning and to make me feel it's worth all the hard work and tears in practicing to make someone's life a little better. From generation to generation, composers strive to achieve the freedom of expression, strive to discover the beauty of the world with new compositional ideas, methods, breaking the boundaries of thoughts, concepts. And I am a big advocate for newly composed good music. And I have done lots of premieres. But I tell you, some composers really gone far to make an impression. Once I had to sing a song while shaking a tree branches to make rustle sound. Another time, all the cast were not feeling it, a new composer's work. We're wondering why. Not only I didn't feel it, my colleagues also felt like, what is this? And one day the composer took us to his studio and pointed out a huge giant machine. And he said, I love this baby. It's a computerized big machine. He said that because this machine does most of the composing for him. He said he did took time and tried to figure out the formula of Bach's music. And using the machine, yeah. And then he think that he found some patterns of his own. despite of his hard work and analysis and efforts, but all of us musicians felt hard to connect with his work. And the music really sound awful. Well, I'm not mentioning his name. It actually really confirmed my idea of art. It's something raised above all. To create an art, there need to be intuition, imagination, and that so-called little genius we may all have. If it's reduced to facts and reality, or simply to mimicking or to making impression, the most I can call is craftsmanship. Art is linked intellectual, emotional, and spiritual. And it's beautiful. It's certainly easy to be said than done. A dear friend of mine, a colleague of mine, I've been working for a long time, collaborating, is a well-known composer. I'm not mentioning his name. He once told me, quote, "I tell you, our masters have done great works with those 12 notes. It's very hard. It's not easy for composers nowadays to write something unique, new, and still beautiful." But there is a hope, because this same composer recently wrote a grand opera called Dr. Sun Yat-sen. It's about the Chinese revolutionary, the father of democracy in China. His revolution was in 1911, way before Communist Party and the Kuomintang Party. He's the founder of the Kuomintang Party, the Nationalist Party. So this composer took all the elements from the music making in East and West and combined his own experiences and humanity, made this wonderful work. It's really doing well. We're going to produce it with the Santa Fe Opera in 2014. I was very honored to be part of this wonderful music making. And I was Mrs. Song Qingling, the wife of Dr. Sun Yat-sen, in the opera. I wish I was taller. People say I look a little bit like her. I knew my composer friend took 4 years to write it, which is unusual in nowadays. Because I have known composers, now, especially in China, so much money, you write a number tonight. Tomorrow we're going to have a party. So people are just rushing deadline to compose, because everything's so fast. But he took 4 years to write it. But I think it's well worth it. Because beauty is the truth, and truth will last. All composers would like their works to last and to be cherished a million years later. I will finish my speech with a true story that continued to inspire me. A few years ago, I got to sing Susanna from the Marriage of Figaro with the Utah Festival Opera. The first cast company meeting was held at the beautiful Alan Esso's Theater. And the founder, UFOC founder and music director Michael Ballum, pointed at the beautiful hall and told us this story. The new classic structured theater was the principal venue and auditorium for Cache Valley Performing Arts Center for decades. Over the years, performances ceased and the theater was allowed to deteriorate. The stage was empty and the orchestra pit silent, lights dimmed in the auditorium, and dirt and accumulated in the dressing rooms. In 1998, the theater was threatened with demolition. The proposed demolition plan came to the attention of Mr. Michael Ballum. He instead proposed a restoration plan that was to be decided by the city council. The votes from both sides, yes or no, were very close. One undecided council member asked Mr. Ballum, "Why do we need to spend so much money on this theater? It doesn't provide me a basket of bread." Mr. Ballum answered with a beautiful smile on his face, "Dear lady, we have been admiring your rose garden for years. We knew that you put lots of heart into it. This theater is like the beautiful roses in your garden. Would you consider cutting back on your bread sometime and have more roses?" One minute later, the restoration plan was passed. Schiller said, "It is through beauty that on proceeds to freedom." Today, I encourage you and I dare you and thank you to have courage to enjoy the power of beauty in the world. And when we are growing the roses and smell them, please do not forget to invite our children along, because they might not be a Chinese girl who lost her mother, but they are the children of the world, the beauty of the world, and they need the love and sunlight like all of us. Thank you.
Okay, so now I'd like to call Ms. Helga Zeplerush back up. Helga, come. You. I'd like for Helga to conclude our panel here for today.
Actually, I really would like to ask you if you can sing something for us. I know it's not fair because you're not warmed up, but you know, I think you have spoken so beautifully that I think we all have an absolute desire to have this rose from you of singing.
Thank you. sees them.
After this beautiful paradigm shift in action, I don't want to make a long speech. I just wanted to remind people that, you know, we want to have a new paradigm, and classical culture is the most important, and classical music obviously is what speaks to the heart in the most powerful way. So I thank you very much because you expressed exactly what we'd want to do. And therefore, I would like to really ask people to come tonight, and then we have some more discussion, we have some more music, and we will have some of the discussion you all obviously urgently wanted to entertain, and let's do it tonight.